Perestroika is designed to produce a stronger, more competitive Soviet superpower. It's a program that affects political, economic, and social institutions, and even individual thinking. Experts such as Peter Reddaway say before Gorbachev can achieve the goals of Perestroika, he needs to improve the sluggish Soviet economy.
That you couldn't achieve progress in any sphere, political, social, economic, foreign policy, until you had a fundamental improvement of the whole performance of the Soviet economy.
One of Perestroika's components is Glastnost, a new openness. On a recent WorldNet program, Marshall Goldman, an authority on the Soviet economy, explained that Glasnost calls for people to speak out about the economy and invites people to speak out on other issues as well.
Intellectuals can't be confined to a very narrow channel to do only what the leadership wants. And therefore, what we're seeing is throughout the Soviet Union, not just in Armenia or Azerbaijan, but throughout the Soviet Union, we're seeing different nationality groups speak out in a way we haven't really seen since the time of the revolution itself.
Scholars say the Soviet political structure has in the past encouraged passivity. They say the Soviet people were expected to do what they were told and were not expected to show personal initiative. These scholars also say General Secretary Gorbachev recognizes he needs to make Soviet society more open.
I think he's right in feeling that you will not get innovative new ideas in the economy, and more, even more importantly, will you get the motivation on the part of ordinary Soviet people to engage in reforming the economy, to put their backs into it, put their ideas into it, unless you have this sort of opening up and loosening of the whole of society and of individual thinking.
Perestroika also affects foreign policy. In December, the Soviets signed an accord to eliminate intermediate-range nuclear weapons. This spring, they agreed to pull their troops out of Afghanistan. Marshall Goldman explains these actions in economic terms.
I think Gorbachev's main preoccupation, his main concern, is with the economy. He realizes, however, that to divert the resources to the civilian population, that he has to, if he's going to make a significant change, he's got to reduce world tensions.
Mikhail Gorbachev says he will continue his restructuring program despite opposition. He told party chiefs in January his reforms were on track. But Peter Reddaway says it's too early to tell how effective the economic reforms are going to be. He says if the Soviets are serious about reform, they will have to accept the reality of unemployment, and prices on housing and food will have to go up. Price hikes in Poland in the 1970s created the Solidarity Labor Union. Solidarity is now outlawed, but it still has a social, economic, and political impact in Poland. In March, Dmitry Symes told a WorldNet audience the Soviets did not have a master plan when Perestroika was first initiated.
Initially, they were hopeful that a more piecemeal reform would do, but now they increasingly feel that something very comprehensive has to be done. And the question is, of course, can you do something comprehensive in reforming the Soviet political and economic system without overthrowing the system itself? That is a $64 question, and I suspect the Soviets themselves still do not know the answer.
Carol Pearson, WorldNet News.
Regional conflicts and human rights are closely intertwined. They are issues of moral conscience. They are issues of international security. Because when a government abuses the rights of its own people, it is a grim indication of its willingness to commit violence against others.
Last month, President Reagan called on the Soviet Union to comply with the human rights provision of the Helsinki Accords, a provision the Soviet Union and 34 other countries agreed to in 1975.
Two of the most basic rights that we've called on the Soviets to comply with under the Helsinki Accords are the right to emigrate and the right to travel. How can we help but doubt a government that mistrusts its own people and holds them against their will?
For years, the Soviet Union dismissed charges it was not living up to its commitments under the Helsinki Accords. The agreement calls on the signatories to honor basic human rights, the right to free speech, the right to freedom of religion, the right to leave one's country. In the months leading up to the Moscow summit, it became clear neither side expects to sign a treaty this spring to cut strategic weapons.
We will continue our effort with strategic arms negotiation if we don't reach agreement by the time of the summit.
The day U.S. Secretary of State George Shultz delivered that message to the NATO allies, White House spokesman Marlon Fitzwater said other issues, human rights and regional conflicts, would receive heavy attention in Moscow this spring. The annual human rights report by the U.S. State Department records violation after violation of basic human rights by the Soviet government. But this report also notes some changes that occurred in the Soviet Union last year. Changes in the way the Soviets handled dissent, and a greater tolerance for protest and protesters. Before Soviet leader Gorbachev came to Washington last December, Jewish groups demonstrated for the freedom of Soviet Jews. 8,000 Soviet Jews were allowed to leave for the West last year, the greatest number since the 1970s. And this year, the number is expected to be even higher. In addition, 14,000 ethnic Germans and 3,000 Armenians were granted exit visas. The Soviets have also introduced laws to prevent psychiatric abuse.
They've been releasing some people, some dissidents from mental hospitals, but by no means all. And they have introduced new legislation about the rights of mental patients with the aim of trying to prevent completely unjustified psychiatric internments of dissidents.
Soviet scholar Peter Reddaway says it is too early to tell how effective these reforms will be.